welcoming you to the first workshop of our 10th program year, a year in which our theme is Citizenship on the Edge, and we will have a series of discussions in ways in which gender, race, sexual identities are bound up with marginalized forms of civic identity in the United States and in other parts of the world. The program is being done in partnership with the Alice Paul Center and Gender, Sexuality, and Women's Studies program. They have done a terrific job of planning under the leadership of Nancy Hirschman, the head ICP. And I also want to note that the planning committee included Melissa Sanchez, who's here, and Deborah Thomas, and the SAS Dean's Office have recently approved the appointment of Deborah Thomas to the Brownlee Chair, a position that involves teaching that is a value to gender, sexuality, and women's studies, as well as humanity and gender. And our program year began with an opening event in which we had a panel on issues of gender, race, sexuality in the presidential election. And both before and after the panel, at least one of the candidates' rhetoric has been going out of his way to show how pertinent these themes are in this election year. But, thankfully, the election will be over soon. And we will turn to some of the hard issues of public policy and civic life that we will be concerned with throughout the year. And we begin with one of those issues today, a session titled Life on the Edge, Central American Asylum Seekers and the Limits of U.S. Liberalism. Our speaker is... Our speaker is very eager. But let me tell you a little bit about her. It's María Josefina Saldaña-Portillo, who is Associate Professor of Social and Cultural Analysis at NYU. She received her PhD in Modern Thought and Literature from Stanford and her BA in English Literature from Yale. She is the author of many articles, but also two books, The Revolutionary Imagination in the Americas and The Age of Development in 2003, and mostly recently, Indian Given, Racial Geographies Across Mexico and the U.S., Duke University Press, 2016. And I want to note that when we have speakers who were undergraduates at Yale, where I taught for two decades long ago, and long enough ago so that Josie was an undergraduate, I always commend them on the fact that they have gone on to such professional success despite never having taken one of my courses, which is an all too frequent pattern. But in this case, the joke is doubly on me for another reason, and that is that in my scholarship in recent years, I've been making some not very popular arguments that when it comes to immigration and refugee policy, the United States should set its priorities with special attention to those parts of the world that have been shaped by the coercive policies of the United States that create special obligations that we should honor. And although I've applied this argument to Mexico and parts of Latin America, I was not clear really how it applied to the recent Central American asylum seekers. And the papers for today provide important evidence and arguments that the recent increase in coercive deportations have had an effect of encouraging the kind of gang violence that has in turn generated asylum seekers to the U.S. So I found this an enormously valuable argument that I felt I should have known but didn't, and so I'm grateful. I'm also grateful that our discussant is a better informed person than I am, and that is my colleague Tullia Folletti, who is the class of 1965 associate professor in political science here at Penn, and also director of our Latin American and Latino Studies program. She's the author of Decentralization and Subnational Politics in Latin America, co-editor of the Oxford Handbook on Historical Institutionalism, and many articles, and she also co-chaired the planning committee for a very successful Democracy, Citizenship, and Constitutionalism program year a couple of years ago, when we focused on political transformations in post-neoliberal Latin America, and that is the basis of what I think is going to be a terrific forthcoming volume that she has co-edited with Emilio Prado of our sociology department. Our format will be as usual. Papers were available. I hope most of you have had a chance to get a look, and Josie will summarize the points that she's most interested in having us develop in discussion. Tullia will provide discussant comments for about 15 minutes, and then we'll open it up to everybody. And so now, join me in welcoming.
Thank you so much. I really want to thank the Penn Program on Democracy, Citizenship, and Constitutionalism, the Alice Paul Center for Research on Gender, Sexuality, and Women, and the Latin American Latino Studies Program for hosting this event. And in particular, I want to thank Melissa Sanchez for inviting me to participate in the Citizenship on Edge seminar this year to kick it off, as it were. So I am going to give you a little bit of a sense of what has drawn me to this work that's actually took me a little bit by surprise. I didn't intend to be writing on the issue of Central American migration and the refugee crisis that's happening right now. It took me as much surprise in 2014 as I think it has taken all of you and the Obama administration. But given the urgency of the matter, I decided to take it up, but not just because it's urgent, but because it does really grow out of my book, which I have 30% on flutters, Indian Given. In the epilogue, the book Indian Given is theorizes or traces the historical genealogy of the idea of the Indo-Barbaro, the barbarous Indian, in both the United States and in Mexico, and the way in which the two governments have colluded in the production of that since the colonial period to the present. And 5 centuries isn't enough. So I really wanted to end with the kind of political urgency that motivated me to write that book, believe it or not, to start that project 6 years ago. And that was the frequency with which Mexican immigrants to the United States and narcos, drug dealers, traffickers, really the best word for them is narcos, the way in which they're always reviled, right? And I wanted to, that's part of what motivated me to write the book, the way in which they're often represented in these barbarous terms, you know, that's most outside the norm of human behavior. And I didn't expect for it to be quite so prescient when I thought about the book 6 years ago, and Trump has made it all too evident how easily we go to the idea of the Mexicans as rapists and murderers and drug dealers. And so the book argues that that's a little bit, it tries to explain the way in which we get to that representation of Mexican immigrants and drug dealers. But the epilogue looks specifically at the imbrication between the NAFTA Accord, the North American Free Trade Accord, and the burgeoning drug economy, and I won't bore you with the details, but it's really actually instrumental, the liberalization of trade with a kind of huge burst, you know, that we see in drug trafficking from Mexico involved in drug trafficking. And let's not forget that Mexico has provided poppy and marijuana to the United States since the 19th century. So the argument that the book makes in the epilogue is that the kind of resurgence or the huge growth in that drug economy is largely facilitated by the North American Free Trade Agreement, and it looks very specifically at that. And so I was happily prepared to go on and write my second book on the connection between the North American Free Trade Accord and the drug economy. I've been teaching on the topic for 10 years. For 18 years. One of the very first classes that I designed for the very first time I taught at UC Santa Barbara was a course called Globalization, Immigration, and Postcolonial Identity. And in that class, I thought, among other kinds of migrations, the class was about the way in which development aid actually ends up triggering immigration to the United States, looking at, you know, various groups historically, and focusing on NAFTA for a good part of that class. I then went on to teach a course called NAFTA, and of course, that's the course I developed about 10 years ago, and I've been teaching that. But I didn't really imagine myself including immigration in that. I mean, of course, as part of the analysis of the North American Free Trade Accord, I have thought about how immigration is motivated by trade for decades, as I said, but I hadn't really intended to focus on migration. I was much more interested in the way in which the combination of NAFTA and the drug economy has led to the dispossession of indigenous peasantries in Mexico. You might not know that a substantial portion of the 12 million Mexicans that have immigrated to the United States are peasants, indigenous peasant peoples, right? So they'll often migrate, entire communities will migrate together. The men and the young boys, and oftentimes even some of the women from those groups, will migrate together to the United States, and they will perform agricultural labor in the United States. So I wanted to touch on that. I was thinking about talking about that. And then, you know, this crisis occurred. And it reminded me of my, you know, first passion, which was actually Central America. My first book is on Central America and revolutions, and also the Zapatista Revolution of 1994. So I actually have a lot of, I wasn't completely taken by surprise that there was this immigration crisis, but more importantly, I really understood the relationship, the historical and economic relationship between the United States and Central America that would lead to this migration crisis. So the second paper I presented for the group, Central American Women, Asylum Seekers, and the Limits of U.S. Liberalism, focuses on some of the reasons why these women are here now, these women and their children are here now. And it's very important to remember, especially in the context of the theme for this seminar, it's very important to remember that the United States has been really instrumental in creating the cartel, the gang violence. I'm not sure that I would call, does anybody know who the Maras are? The Maras, Maras Zapatruchas. The Maras and the Maras Zapatruchas, who are, let's just call them the Maras for to make it easier. The Maras Zapatruchas are the dominant gangs in the Northern Triangle, Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador. Notably, Nicaragua is not suffering these problems. We can talk about that in question and answer. I didn't actually include it in the paper, but I think it's kind of an exemplary, it kind of proves the point, right? So in El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras, during, you know, the U.S. was very involved in the counter-revolutionary wars in El Salvador and Guatemala in the 1980s. And of course, Honduras was the launching ground for the counter-revolutionary war against the Sandinistas. So in doing that, in intervening in that way, they sent a considerable number of refugees to our country, right? Because these wars were absolutely devastating. The Truth Commission in Guatemala reports that 400 villages were razed. 250,000 people were murdered, mostly by the paramilitaries and the right-wing militaries that were there. So these caused this huge influx, which some of you are old enough to remember, but most of you aren't, tens of thousands of immigrants to the United States. Now, because they were fleeing right-wing dictatorships that the U.S. backed, those three countries, were not recognized as political refugees. Thus, their parents found it very difficult. Some did finally, through lots of arbitration in the courts, some were able to get political refugee status, but the vast majority were not. They were living here as undocumented peoples, and they brought their children as undocumented peoples. In contrast, Nicaragua, there was a revolutionary government in control there, and consequently, the United States, every Nicaraguan who came here fleeing the war, was immediately granted the same kinds of rights that the Cuban refugees have been granted, right? They're immediately received citizenship, or they put on a path to citizenship. They received very much considerable economic assistance in terms of housing, job opportunities, food, clothing. So it's a very, they were in a very different situation, and their children were immediately legalized. So what happens, fast forward, I won't bore you with you know, the U.S. Dirty wars in Central America anymore, but what happens is that in the 1990s, in 1996, the Clinton administration and Congress passed a bill that's called IRRIA, IRA, right, which is gives the United States permission to deport anyone who commits a crime that is not a U.S. citizen. And so consequently, in just to El Salvador alone, 40,000 maras de la Truchas were sent, kids were sent back. Now these kids didn't speak Spanish, they didn't remember the country. Yes, they may have some distant relatives, but you know, their entire, they've been raised here, and of course the maras as a street gang, it starts in Los Angeles. And in Los Angeles, it's you know, a gang that's developed by Salvadorans and other undocumented Central Americans to protect themselves from the Mexican gangs. But because that, and then they themselves divide between the MS-13 and the MS-18. But together, we can call them maras. So they're sent back, brought, you know, 40,000 to El Salvador, tens of thousands more to Guatemala and Honduras, and they become a criminal syndicate that's very important in Central America, which gets us to the topic of today's paper. I did 45 interviews with Central American women who were fleeing to the United States, in part because it's my backyard. There's a residential center in Dilley, Texas, the residential centers as they call it, and I'm from Laredo, Texas. So I was motivated to move, to go there and work with these women. I only work for 1 week, so one might say, how do you get to the United States in 1 day? Well, it's because we had to be at the facility at 7:45, and we had to work until 8 p.m. And we did, the center provided 4 services, but what I did primarily was intake. That was processing women as they arrived daily, on a daily basis, into the CARA system. The CARA is the program that assists these women in these centers, both in Dilley and in Karnes, Texas, and actually also here in Berks in Pennsylvania. We have another family detention center. There are only 3 in the country. So we did the intakes of about 50 to 80 women per day, and we did credible fear interview preps. And from the, I mean, I have to say, I've been in Latin American studies a really, really long time, and I'm not quite sure I was expecting so many credible cases, to be quite honest. But I was really surprised that the 45 preps that I did, I would say 43 of them, to me, were so detailed, so specific, and so consistent that they had credibly left their countries because of violence at the hands of the maras. And the maras, the cases I speak about in this paper, the maras do generally extort what they call a war tax. And the war tax, it is on every business. They have to pay this war tax. So the largest group of women who are fleeing are women who have been subjected to this war tax but can't pay it. They've been paying it all along, but for something will happen and they can't pay it. The payment's interrupted. Which is understandable, right? Because it takes up a larger and larger share of their business earnings, and so they can't replenish their inventories. And so consequently, once they can no longer pay, they are expected to provide other services. And this is where the aspects of gender and sexuality come into it. There's a number of women who reported that once they were no longer able to pay, the maras asked for their daughters, right? So their daughters would then be, in other words, in lieu of payment, they could give their daughters to prevent drugs, to be washouts. As young as 10, the kids, when they turn 10, are considered young enough to join the maras as lookouts. They're not necessarily doing anything except like keeping watch for the police or keeping watch for rebel gang members. Sometimes they're doing distribution, as the women explained to me. So they're as young as 10, and the women are very creative in how they've staved this off, because they do try to stave off having to give the girls, to, you know, obviously they have no plans to give the girls, but they try to stave off the maras as long as possible, and then finally decide to leave because they can no longer, get away with evading them. And these women have done many things, like they've moved neighborhoods, they've implored their relatives in the United States to send money, they've sent the girls to other parts of the country, they've tried other options, but these options have failed them because the maras are extensive. So as many of them would tell me, if I leave to another part of the country, these are small places. They're going to know I'm you. They're going to immediately want to know which maras I'm from. Am I MS-13, MS-18? Even though they're not of the mara, what neighborhood they come from. And they'll quickly communicate back and forth. So that's one group of women who flee because, you know, they do not want to put their girls into sexual servitude. They themselves are often, if the mothers are considered young enough, they are also themselves harassed by the maras to become their sexual concubines. And the number of stories these women told me that they had virtually made them prisoners of their homes, because the moment they stepped outside of the home, and even sometimes it didn't matter if they stepped outside because the maras were literally on their front stoop. Right, they would be harassed by the maras and endangered by the maras, and we can get into some more of that, those details if need be. But my point is that these women have been expected to provide a certain kind of sexual services, so reproductive labor, because there are also those women who took to paying the war tax by providing food for the maras, right? Who every day had to provide lunch for the maras. And the maras, there was this one woman who told me that the maras would come over to her house. And, she even had like a sense of motherly responsibility towards them. But when she was no longer able to feed them, they immediately demanded, payment and her daughter in exchange for no longer being able to provide food. So there's a way in which these women, all business owners in Central America, are pressured to provide these war tax, but women are vulnerable in unique ways, both because of the threat of sexual violation of themselves, but also the threat of sexual violations of their daughters. And again, as I said, it's not that men wouldn't feel as much anguish as these women about these situations. It's just also the case that the women, because so many of them are single mothers, are also vulnerable in another way. They're vulnerable because they are they're seen by the maras as not having any man to stand up for them, right? And so that's another way in which their gender influences the way in which they're treated by the maras, because there's not a man to mediate. They are single income households, and therefore they're even more precarious, right? Their economic situation is more precarious. And so the questions that this experience of these women really provoked for me, or led me to think about, are several. The first, of course, being the question of how do we think. We tend to think of citizenship and nationality as a bounded experience, right? That the nation and the citizenship rights are tied to the boundaries of your nation. But one of the things that I talk about or would love to help thinking about is, the U.S., by deporting these maras, has created a set of rules, and then the safety of our citizens in the United States is contingent on the exporting of criminality to these Central American countries. So how does that challenge the way in which we think about citizenship, when our citizenship is purchased at the cost of these populations in the Northern Triangle, as Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador are known. And especially if we think about our role in not just in having imported the Maras, but having created the situation in which we had a refugee crisis in the 1980s that led to the bringing of children here who remained in undocumented status for so long, who then were trained in the drug distribution and gang structures of California, living on the streets of LA and San Francisco, and who then get shipped back to the United States under IIRA, which is still in effect. I'm very troubled when, obviously I'm troubled when I hear, Trump describe Mexicans as rapists and murderers and drug dealers, but I'm also equally troubled by how adamant, how much agreement there is between Trump, Obama, and Clinton about the need to deport the criminals and the undocumented criminals. Like, that's just a standard go-to line. And I think what hopefully a seminar like this can help us to think about is precisely the way in which what seems like an absolute right of us as our citizenship and our constitutional democracy to be able to decide who gets to stay and who has to go, and especially that there can be so much agreement about the need to deport these criminals, really obfuscates the degree to which we have so played such a foundational role in the construction of these boys as criminals, right? Boys and men. So that to me is a very, very troubling, and I don't really know how to address it in the larger work issue, the fact that we, the United States citizens, have actively shaped our citizenship, or protected ourselves at the expense of other people. The other, I think, really urgent question that's raised by these women's stories is, well, experiences, they're not stories, these women's experiences is, how do we discuss this level of violence, this level of gendered violence, without slipping into a kind of Chandra Mohanty's under Western eyes critique, how do we discuss the violence that's perpetrated against these women without, on the one hand, obfuscating the fact that, young boys are also the victims of modern violence? We're here, the women have come here with their children, and because of the kind of way in which family is thought of in the United States, they're received as especially tragic victims. But how do we think about that without, on the one hand, forgetting the men and boys who are also the victims of this violence? And on the other hand, without falling into a kind of savage Latin American culture's narrative, right? Without falling into the usual traps of death by culture. Like, there's nothing we can do about it because this is just the machismo of their culture. That's the best of it, or the worst of it is like, oh my God, they're so atavistic, they're so out of control. Why, it's their problem. We've had nothing to do with it. So I want us to, also think about how we think about gendered violence around citizenship without falling into the same kinds of traps. And I think that might do it for me. I did have one other thing I wanted to say before closing. And that is that even though the papers I've given you are on Central American refugees fleeing violence from the Northern Triangle and about the detention centers, I am 100% sure, maybe I'm Pollyanna, I did believe Mondale was going to win way back when, but I am 100% convinced that Hillary Clinton will close the family detention centers. But there are only three family detention centers. There's one detention center that's just for unaccompanied minors. And there's a number of detention centers where the men are sent. Right? Because these family detention centers are just for women and children, families are often split up at the border, so the men go to other detention centers. Right? But I think we can be pretty confident that Clinton will shut down these centers, but I hope that a forum like this one will continue the conversation, because the centers, are not necessarily the problem. 90% of the women who are at these centers, because of the good work of CADA, and because their cases are so real, do pass the credible fear interviews, 90% of them, over 90%, depending on which day or week it is, right? So these women aren't getting a chance to apply for asylum. Passing the credible fear interview is just the first step on applying for asylum. But my point is, even if we were to close the detention centers, even if we were able to admit all Central American refugees who are fleeing this violence, right, as recognize their condition as that of refugee status, that wouldn't change the fact that the nature of Central American citizenship is so bounded with U.S. citizenship, and the kinds of decisions we make here are really affecting millions of people there, and the kinds of decisions we make to protect our citizens here. Okay, that's really the end. Thank you.
Important application and consequences as we also think about U.S. foreign policy in the Middle East. But let's stay with Central America. At the time when the Republican candidate indeed demonizes Mexicans and Latinos as violent criminals, it is illuminating to read her paper, which has Rogers commented in his introductory remarks, makes a very clear connection between the U.S. foreign policies of the 80s, the creation of the MARA gang in Los Angeles, and then a second round of foreign policies in the 90s with the Immigration Reform Act that makes women and children have to flee from Central America, creating another wave of undocumented immigrants. As I mentioned before, one such group was the Garofina Cimarron Black Indigenous women, who, as the paper argued based largely on a rumor about U.S. favorable policies towards them, flee Honduras, leaving behind collective indigenous lands that, perhaps not surprisingly, were very valuable to economic corporations. There are also the narratives of the women interviewed at the detention center in Texas, who fled because they could no longer provide the means for daily reproduction of the Maras, or because they were prey of sexual violence. So we see in this paper that U.S. intervention in Latin America and Central America in particular has had implications for the rights of citizens, implications for the political regimes of the regions, as we know, even implications for the type of democracy that has been triumphant in the region. I would argue that our way of thinking about democracy as formal democracy, as a polarchy, where as long as there are free and fair elections, we are willing to call it a democracy, has to do with the defeat of the process of Marxist, radical, participatory, indigenous democracy that U.S. foreign policy has sought to eliminate from the region, and they have done this quite systematically. But now, we agree on that. My questions are, in relation to U.S. foreign policies towards Latin America, do you see any possibility for the articulation of some other contestatory discourse in Latin America, and perhaps in Central America in particular? And here I'm particularly curious, given your previous work on revolutionary projects in Central America, or will desperate people continue to exit to the north, leaving behind valuable indigenous collective lands, or leaving behind their pulperias or tiendas and everything else, and risking everything to get to the north? The second question in relation to this topic is, what is the role of the domestic elites in these processes? Obviously, the U.S. is not acting alone, has not been acting alone since the beginning of the Cold War. So what is the role of the military, of the police, of the ruling elected officials? We have a glimpse of these in the analysis of the corporations in the Garofina paper, and we have a glimpse of this in the analysis of the police and the constraints that the police is acting on in the case of the refugee migrants detained in Texas. But I wonder if you could tell us more about, you know, under what conditions these policies are having the effects they are having on the ground. And finally, and perhaps relatedly, what could it be done when the state, this is Central American states, do not have, perhaps even Mexico, do not have legitimate control of the monopoly of force within their territories anymore? Is legalization of illicit drugs the only effective, and perhaps we could say moral solution to this problem, or do you think there are other policy possibilities? Then, on the meaning of being a minority in the US, I think at a time when, very unfortunately, it has become patently obvious in the US, and perhaps, you know, I am talking as a new migrant because I didn't live during the civil rights era. Perhaps to those who lived during that time, this is not so surprising. But at least for the last 20 years that I've lived here, this is a time when perhaps, as not at a time in my 20 years here, it has become very obvious the segregation in housing, health, schools, security in the streets that minority communities are subject to. I don't think it's a stretch to say that minority communities are second-class citizens in these countries whose rights are being systematically violated, including their lives. So I think your paper invites us to think more about the limits of citizenship both abroad and at home in the US. And I think the question you start your critical Latino-Latina indigeneities paper, what is an Indian, not an Indian, is very good to also prompt us to think about when is a Latino, not a Latino, a Latina. When is the indigenous, or Indian instead, as you come back to this question at the end of the paper. But following that line of reasoning, I'm wondering, when is a refugee not a refugee? You cite what are the causes that give an undocumented migrant refugee status, fleeing persecution because of political affiliation or religious creed, but not race, nationality, or language. You also tell us that under the 2000 Victims of Trafficking and Violence Protection Act, those who are victims of domestic violence can also seek refugee status. So, I'm curious, what do we learn from those two or three interviews that you did, or pre-CFI interviews that you did, that were not credible? What do they tell us about you know, refugee status and policy? And also, as a stop there, I'm sure there will be many other more interesting questions. Thank you.
I think that we might want to stop thinking about a kind of binary between contestatory and non-contestatory vote. I was working when I was there that meeting really with a lot of really young, I mean, I was just co-leading. I hadn't fallen in love with that many people that wanted to, you know, an actress in Central America, but so we were like completely in love with each other, completely in love with each other by the end of the week. But what these men and women kept saying was like, I can't believe how brave they are. I can't believe how strong they are. And of course, I mean, I, you know, cut my teeth in Central America, and I was like, I didn't say, you know, I was like, I know, right? But inside, I was thinking, of course they're this strong, and of course they're this brave, because it is a form of contestation, right? That it's a form of knowing your rights and contesting them, arguing for them when you make that decision to flee. In other words, these are people who were very even aware of the rights they were coming to claim here. You know, a number of these women turn themselves in, right? Or mean to turn themselves in, but they don't understand the law entirely correctly, and so they don't turn themselves in, they get caught, but that's a technicality. In other words, like, these women are actually exercising, I think it would be helpful to think of them as exercising rights when they travel, right? Like, being, understanding themselves as rights-bearing citizens. And I actually think that you're absolutely right. It's like the history of revolutionary ideology is so strong in Central America that these women, because they went, you know, even though they're too young to have necessarily, you know, participated in the wars or whatever, they're coming out of societies that actually, I think, might have a strong civil discourse, even if they don't have, as you're saying, the military and police to enact that civil. In other words, these are places where you have oppositional parties that are revolutionary parties that are now in power. And so I actually think that these women are expressing in a way
a contestatory, you know, demand for the right to be safe. Right? The right to be safe, like other people have the right to be safe, like people in the United States have the right to be safe. And a lot of them, I was actually very surprised by the number of these women who have gone to the police. So to me, that expressed a belief that even their civil society should be able to protect them. That, of course, they weren't able to protect them, but not for not trying. Like many of the police forces actually did try, but that just got women into more trouble, et cetera. So, and like in the case of El Salvador, where you actually have really strong policies against the Maras, those policies aren't having the expected effects. In other words, it's like there are constitutional governments in place that are pressuring or trying to combat this violence. And you're right, they can't combat violence. And I think in part it's because the system, it's a kind of an international system that subtends the Mara, so they're never going to be able to compete with the amount of money and arms and mobility that these drug gangs, members of these drug gangs have, right? In other words, it's like they're flush. They're flush with arms, they're flush with money, they have the ability to go back and forth because they do have this, you know, money. They evade, you know, rival gang actions, they evade police actions. So I think that we don't, this is part of what I'm actually having trouble with. It's like, I don't know that I want to say that this is about failed constitutional democracies in Central America. In part because I know the consequences of saying that, you know, there's failed democracies anywhere, right? I mean, that's not, like, those aren't good words to hear. Saying ever towards Central American countries. I think that I don't know that I know, you know, what's the station. In terms of the military and the police, El Salvador, unlike Guatemala, I mean these are and Honduras, El Salvador did reform its military and its police force as part of the peace negotiations. So I think that again, it's like here's its police force that might actually not be, well, okay. I remember when I first started doing this research and, you know, like everyone else, I was like, oh, well, the police, and I was thinking about Mexico, police just have to be paid more and more respect, blah, blah, blah. It's like, no one is going to be able to pay, no country on earth is going to be able to pay these men and women $10,000, you know, a month. You know, that's just not going to happen. You know, like, can you imagine? It's like they're police force, right? This is what the drug lords can do. And when the drug lords are pressuring you, you're not going to, you're going to take the money. Because as one of the women told me, it was very moving. She, the woman in El Salvador, she was like, well, I didn't go to the police. I don't think they're corrupt, but they're human like we are. And their families are at risk. And, you know, why are they going to stand up against the Maras? You know, the Maras can kill them just as easily as they come us. So, I mean, I don't know. I do believe that, again, a stronger military police force obviously would be very good in combating these crimes. On the other hand, who are they going to turn to for that money? They're going to turn to the United States, and that money's going to come with consequences. And one of the consequences that has come from Mexico, for example, has been an insistence that Mexico play a role in detaining and deport. Right, so now Mexico has detention centers on its southern border that are private centers that are funded, you know, that are funded in part through U.S. aid, right? Because this has all happened really quickly. I mean, this is just in the last couple of years. Mexico has been cooperating on detaining and deporting women, and Mexico does give asylum. Actually, some of the women I talked to had received asylum in Mexico, but have continued moving because their friends and family are here. So I do think that a stronger something needs to be in place, but I'm not quite sure what that something would be. And a stronger military or a stronger police force is always going to be, you know, come at the expense of like a continued drug war on drugs. Can you legalize all drugs? Well, you would never be able to legalize all drugs in this country. Should we? Yes. I mean, I do think with Vicente Fox, I never thought I'd say that, but in agreement with Vicente Fox, president of Mexico, I do think that, you know, at least the drugs that are produced, you know, and that flow between South and North America should absolutely be decriminalized. And that it, now, as studies of prohibition have shown, when you decriminalize drugs, there's going to be a spike in violence because these criminal gangs don't want this stuff decriminalized, right? I mean, they're making hand over fist money because it is criminal. Also, it's very, I mean, I don't mean to be so unique, it's a very complicated picture because these drug dealers have really diversified, you know, so now they're in all different kinds of industries, right? You know, human trafficking, drug trafficking, but also real estate, you know, I mean, they're in all sorts of different industries, many of them illicit. It's, I'm not quite sure where we would go from that. That's very bleak.
What did you learn about the ones who did not, who is not a credible?
I learned that they're trying. I was like, you try. You go in there, you tell that story, tell it as convincingly as you can. Try. What's interesting is that, from Guatemala, a lot of the people coming from Guatemala, the women coming from Guatemala, are indigenous, but they won't say so. Because they're, you know, expecting a kind of, you know, that this is going to, there's going to be some kind of implicit racism in the system. What they don't know is that if they are indigenous and they can speak Spanish, they're immediately released because we do not have the services for translation of their indigenous languages. But they don't know that. We convey that. So actually, the cases of the women who I didn't believe, doesn't mean that they were incredible, there were two women who were indigenous. And their stories were identical. They were, I mean, identical. And I was like, you know, they were largely unbelievable. And a lot of that, let's be really clear, a lot of these women, the women I saw, you know, again, not all the women are detained. Many women are captured, not all women are put into detention. They're put into detention dependent upon how many beds are available. So there are some Central American women who are crossing the border and are being released under conditions of bail or, you know, other conditions of supervision because there simply aren't enough beds. But there are also some women in this wide dragnet who are just coming to be reunited with their partners. And, you know, again, I have to say, when that WikiLeaks thing about, you know, Clinton saying, I dream of open borders, I was like, can somebody just say yes? You know, because the problem with NAFTA and CAFTA is that we've created open borders for finance, we've created open borders for products, but we've created even stricter borders for the, you know, containing people. Like, people cannot travel, but their products and foreign domestic investment and drug money and drugs, and everything can flow except the people. So, I mean, if we're going to go down this free trade road, then we should also go down the road of open borders, at least with the NAFTA and CAFTA participants, right? The North American and the Central American Free Trade Accords, because that would certainly be more honest. Of course, I doubt that that's the vision that she has for the borders, but, you know, I was at least relieved to hear someone say it, you know?
Okay, thank you. Now, so that everyone gets a chance, I'll keep a cue, and you should put your hand up, and I'll mark down and make sure that we get to you for too long, but if there's an item in discussion that you are particularly eager to comment right on that point, we do have the two-finger rule where you can jump the queue. Under the penalty, if your comment is not actually related to the point, severe public shame. Keep that in mind.
So, this might go into my third question. I was very struck by a moment in your one of the essays where you talk about the fact that you don't expect these two, I think they're political scientists, to comment in a medium different from the one they're using because, after all, they are seeking to influence policymakers. That's one observation. Not too many people put it as precisely as that. At another point, you corrected yourself when you said their stories, and you said, no, your experiences, and I understand exactly where your emphasis comes from. But it's precisely the opposition between stories and then emotion in stories and an immersion in the kind of political scientific vocabulary that is shared with policymakers that I want you to reflect on. A lot of us are more comfortable in the lessons being taught by the one as a way of re-energizing our engagement with the former at the cost of not being taken seriously, not only by public policymakers, but by a lot of academic institutional practices. So I wonder how you think of your vocabulary and your writing in that mix.
Well, I think the two papers have slightly different political urgency because the situation of the Garifunas is different from the situation of the other Central American women who I spoke with personally. And in the case of the first article of the Garifunas, I was at a certain remove because I was only speaking to the representative of an organization of Garifuna women in the United States. So, but I still think the point is really well taken. I think that if, as academic writing, I would love to be able to actually bridge both to make the personal stories the basis for causing a kind of change in policy, but I don't expect migration studies people to necessarily leave the kind of work that they do behind, which is never based on stories. It's always based on the economic indicators and, you know, the kind of deindustrialization and changes in the methods of industrialization. That work is so useful to me that I'm not suggesting that they stop doing it. But these are some of the most valiant and committed activist scholars that we have. And I think that, you know, I think that perhaps to break through it, you actually do need the personal stories, but they're not necessarily, you know, they're number crunchers and they're really good at what they do. So I think it actually does depend on the work of somebody like me who's really comfortable in their idioms and very comfortable with the economics of it, but actually is much more focused on the nuance of the story to cross that divide. And that's a big political responsibility. So a friend of mine who was a journalist for years, she still is a journalist, but anyway, that's a long story. She's like, you have to write an op-ed, you have to write an op-ed, you have to write an op-ed. And so I keep turning out these 700 word things and she's like, no, that's not an op-ed. You know, so it's also like, I'm very good at listening to the subtleties of these stories and picking out the kind of enmeshed nature of, you know, the interdisciplinarity of their stories, the way they're connecting with everything. And I'm very good to convey it with an audience like you, but I think it's another, you know, it's yet another skill that I'm going to need to learn to actually influence policy. And so these migration scholars, they're in an idiom that does convince Congress people, you know, sometimes, not always, but sometimes, you know, does have success in that sense.
Thank you, both of you, for the presentation and the amazing discussion. This question is not completely formed, but I want to think about gender as a theoretical concept in all of this, as well as a lived concept. And I guess the simplest version of the question would be, is safety gendered? So I was struck when you were talking about these female refugees' flight as a form of contestation or an assertion of ID. Of identity, sorry, identity as a rights-bearing citizen, right? And thinking about that in conjunction with Tulia's question of when is a refugee not a refugee, or where does criminality and refugee status meet or converge in these discussions and in the popular imaginations of these terms that have been so present in our current national discourse. So, you know, when Trump talks about, you know, says that we need rapists and criminals, he's constructing this threat of the, you know, illegal alien as itself a kind of threat against a feminized that, so that, you know, asserting one's rights to be safe also becomes a and vulnerability. But your work seems to be challenging that kind of easy allegory in a certain way that I can't quite put my finger on. And I wonder if it comes down to the question of what is credible fear? And what does it mean to be able to assert the right to cross borders through the language of fear of someone? So, again, I guess I'm not exactly sure what my question is, but it does have to do with this larger whole web of association.
Well, I mean, I think that's at every stage of this migration process and seeking a refugee status, it's an incredibly gendered process, and it's gendered to favor women and children, precisely because of a sense that we have that women and children should be protected. I mean, just beginning with that kind of bias, right, the idea that women and children should just automatically have a special access to getting our end. So I think, you know, well, let's use it. You know, that's just the way it is. I mean, we're not gonna, you know, get somewhere by saying, well, it should not be that way. But even the way in which these detention centers are structured, women and children get separated. In many cases, it's entire families that are fleeing, but they get separated from their husbands, and the husbands get put into all male detention centers, and they get put into these residential centers that are just for women and children, so men can't be there. So from that, you know, and sometimes you'll you know, that was part of the job that we were doing. We were trying to reunite them or find out where the husbands or sons. If the sons are over 18, they cannot go with their mothers. So we're very busy, like, trying to find where the, you know, some of the work that Shada does is try to locate these people. So I do think that, you know, gender, the vulnerability, the different, this is one thing I really want to underscore. It's not that women and children are more vulnerable to drug, the violence at the hands of the Maras. It's that they're vulnerable in different ways. And I do, you know, try to, I'm not quite sure where we go with that, but I do try to underscore that in the paper. It's like, I'm not going to suggest that fathers would be similarly anguished at the fates of their daughters, right? But they're, you know, it's the women that choose to flee with the daughters because of this particular nature of their vulnerability. But boys are vulnerable in other ways too, right? You know, boys are just as vulnerable to being induced into the gangs or, you know, to be made gang members or, you know, be killed, right? Or have to flee. I'm not sure about answering your question, but I do think that we have to recognize that refugee law, it does benefit these women in some way, and that's fine. I'm ready to use it, you know, to benefit them. But as I said, I actually think that if we recognize this, if we should let in all Central American refugees from gang violence, because we've participated in creating those conditions of violence, right? But I don't expect to convince anyone on the Hill of that, or even Hillary Clinton of that, right? But there's also, that's why I feel that it's the gendered nature of Clinton's claim that she's going to end family detention. That's what makes me believe her, right? She's gonna be grandma, she'll be the grandmother that rectifies the system. And it will seem like a very big deal, but it won't address the larger problems, right? And I think the larger problems it's not about more violence against women, it's about the different natures of violence and the different avenues of recourse that are open to them because of that. The domestic violence visa, it's like, I mean, at the end, you're just like, you know, man, that was a really bad case, she's gonna get through. Because domestic violence, 99% chance. And there were four cases of domestic violence, one of which actually was the most perplexing of all the cases, but these women are going to get the visa. And again, it's like, that's definitely not, you know, that's outside. Well, this woman crossed the Mara divide, one per case, but the other three cases, it's political insofar as gendered violence is political. but they are not a category of suffering discrimination in the same way that, you know, somebody's suffering discrimination because of race or religion, or, I mean, or maybe they are, right? But it, we do have this really, really big exception in the, you know, refugee law. It's not even, they're not even refugees, it's a special kind of visa that's passed under an entirely separate act in the year 2000. It's like it's a UV visa, I think it's called a UV visa. And so, I mean, even in the United States, I do work with women, and, you know, we do these legal clinics in New York City, and, you know, it's whenever you hear, these women don't come in because they know about this visa. They come in to talk about something else, and then in the process, you find out that their husband or their boyfriend has beat them, and the boys are like, oh my God, who cares about that other stuff? Tell me about the beating, you know, because that will get them the visa like that. You know, it's just, so even if they're here, you know, and these women who were victims of domestic violence, again, they know the law, they brought evidence. Right? So, I mean, they know about this visa in Central America, right? Because they bring with them evidence of having been battered.
Okay. I wonder, listening to you answer that, this is really, what I wonder is if some of these distinctions between the criminal versus the refugee have to do with fantasy or agency, right? So it's less credible of a narrative to say I'm at risk of being forced to become a criminal.
Even for boys can get, if boys are fleeing and they're under 18, yes, they're also eligible. And there's a whole other route that's for them. So that's great if they're here by themselves. And that's really good for them. But, you know, 18 is the magic number, and after 18, you're like, you know, suddenly you have agency. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
yeah,
so I wanted to talk a little bit more about the gendered aspects of the violence. I was really blown away by the stories of the women that you collected. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you understand these cases conceptually in relationship to better known cases like the you know, when you see those things, you have wives, right? The women who work in the Mecca behind. And one of the things, because I noted, you know, you cited someone in the other paper about the disposability of
Melissa Wright.
So, and one thing that strikes me is that in the case of the maquiladoras, there's also, you know, it's gender violence, it's an expressive violence, but it's a violence that's directly related to capital in the sense that these are, you know, waged women who've entered the wage economy, right? Often themselves migrants from other parts of Mexico, right? Often indigenous, etc. On the other end of the spectrum, the Mara stories, I was completely blown away by the fact this was all forced reproductive labor, right? It's forced unpaid labor, right? It belongs to, but at the same time, one can see them belonging structurally to a single system. But I'm wondering if you can say anything more about the kind of necessity of reproductive labor to the Maras. I mean, obviously, like, they need to eat, right? But it, there seems to be something very symbolic and expressive about the enslavement of women as concubines, for example, right? So I'm just wondering if there's some kind of connection, right? And both, I mean, the case of the Mujeres Tejuares and the case of these women who were made in slavery by the Maras has to do with something about the necessity of women's labor, but also its disposability. I'll stop there.
That's a really, really great question, Erica. I think that I would want to think about it a little bit in the language of Rita Laura Segato. There is a link. If Rita Laura Segato is an Argentine feminist, who is but practices in Brazil and Mexico. Mexico, like, flew her in to deal with the question of feminicide in Mexico, and she gave what to me is the most convincing explanation of the feminicides, and this is why I do think that they are linked. Because I don't think every single feminicide that happened in Juarez was connected to narco violence, but I do think that Rita Lara Segato's is the best explanation, which is that they were training, this was a method of training these gangs that were newly emergent, right, really newly emergent in the early 90s, that this level of gang activity and this quality of gang activity was new for Mexico, and that killing the women was a ritualistic
way of creating a bond among the macros and also customizing them to the violence. It's in the piece is in the volume edited by Rosalinda Fregoso, Terrorizing Women, for those of you who wanna read that piece. And so I do think that there's a way in which feminicides were a training ground for the kind of violence that then ensued. But as Marisa Berastegui-Goitia often says, you know, in her scholarship, now everyone is in danger. Now it's not just a gendered, you know, there's not just a gendered bias in front of these crimes towards women. But I do think that if you use us to think about the reproductive labor as indeed, like, you know, drug activity, like any other activity, is a capitalist activity, right? And it does require reproduction. And these boys who have been sent back, you know, without their parents to these countries are orphaned once they get there. They are effectively orphaned, right? Because they don't necessarily have, you know, the family structures. They don't return to family structures. They arrive and they're kinless in a certain way. So there's a logic to why they need women to perform these roles, right? Because they don't have that structure, right? But they're also an army, right? And again, it's like when we think about the way in which we would, even in you know, this is absolutely no comparison because there was absolutely never this. I don't want to make an analogous relationship at all, but you know, in war, revolutionary armies also distributed the reproductive labor, right? They reproduced the men and, you know, men and women of the troop, and, you know, this is some of the sexism that, you know, revolutionary women complained about, that they were expected to do the cooking, that they were expected to do, you know, this is something that we've heard about. But, of course, these women had joined the revolutionary ranks of their own volition, and they had arguments about this in the ranks, you know, and it's very different. But I do think, like, when you have an army, and the Maras are an army, you need to provide reproductive labor in that way. And this is the form that it takes,
Josie, thanks for the amazing talk. So I think that the exchange you just had with Erica kind of goes back to this question of gender, because there's a logic, a transnational logic here. We have lots of discussions about the ways in which all the various propositions in California or IRA itself is about the outsourcing of reproductive labor. And so the story that you actually tell about Mars in a way is an ethnography of how that outsourcing happens. So I think that that's, you know, one way to think about the gender story that you have here in terms of a transnational circuit of the outsourcing of reproductive labor. My question actually is more along the lines of Sevier's, which is about methodology. I was really struck by the closing of the first essay that you gave us on critical Latino studies and trying to rethink its parameters. And it really struck me that you provided a kind of comparative race model by which indigenous studies and indigenous dispossession and detribalization becomes a form of Latino immigration, that the prison industrial complex and moving from plantations to prisons needs to account for a north-south model that brings in Latino studies. But the question of indefinite detention and the problem of the exploitation of labor, you know, which certainly from my specialty in Asian American studies has a lot of resonance with Latino studies and the creation of legal immigration, brings those fields together. So I was just curious. I know that, you know, you're trained in an interdisciplinary program, but I was wondering, you know, how you might account for this evolution and around comparative race, and what you think is happening to the field. So for instance, is your project, you know, more of a sui generis project, or is this the type of work that has to be done now in terms of ethnic studies, both intellectually and politically?
I definitely think politically it needs to be done. I think in ethnic studies, there's always going to be room for very, you know, historically specific, even within Asian American and Latino studies, you know, there's going to be room, there has to be room for people who want to study Boricua, you know, modernist literature, or, you know, Korean American
narratives, or, you know, I mean, there has to be room for that. But in terms of the pressing political issues of our day, I'm really just struck by the disconnection between the Black Lives Matter movement and the critical prison studies movement and migration studies, and, you know, the disconnection between Native American studies and indigenous studies in Latin America. Because, you know, at this point, Zapotec is the second most spoken indigenous language in the United States, Zapotec, right? So, I mean, I think the kind of just the changing demographics of our day, on the one hand, the fact that the prison industrial complex is international and, you know, or at least trans-American, right, and has really has an origin that war on drugs that has led to the mass incarceration of Blacks and Latinos in the United States has to be tied in politics and in our political scholarship more rigorously together, because it is one story. But how do you tell that one story? You know, that's a really, really complicated and imbricated story. And I have to say, that's not the story I intended to write. I just want to write a little book about not bad free trade and drug economy. But as it's gotten bigger because of the ways in which I've just been struck by the insular nature of race studies, right? Even critical race studies. It might be critical in that it's theoretically critical of essentialist identity formations or paradigms, but it's not critical of the kind of individuation of these fields. You know, that I think is really an important next step. But that I'm going to be addressing, I suppose, now. I was very struck by this because, like I said, I've been teaching about I'm from the border. I'm a person who, in my lifetime, went from like going across the river, like going from Nuevo Laredo, coming back at all hours of the night, like totally like, you know, not caring, to not being able to go to Nuevo Laredo except between the hours of 9 and 2, right? Because narcos need to sleep. So you're pretty safe going between the hours of 9 to 2, you know, and this is it. And it's like by 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and I've got to be driving back to Laredo, you know, this is one community. So I'm very, 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 very concerned about, you know, the transformation of Mexico, obviously. And so Javier Cecilia, whose son was killed in 2011 by narcos, he's a poet, a Mexican poet, very famous. He did a caravan for peace over to, you know, all the way from Mexico City to, you know, all over the United States. It was a really beautiful event. And in New York City, they had the stars of This Is My House, you know, that documentary on a journalist goes back to his hometown and looks up all this, I'm not sure This Is My House, something about houses in it. And it's about all of these African-American friends of his who become drug dealers, right, and drug users. And they were on the stage with the parents of the people who have been killed by narco violence in Mexico. And those drug dealers were bereft. They had no idea. They had no idea the consequences of their actions, right? So they're like weeping. One of the women is like, I'm never gonna sell drugs. I mean, I don't know. It's like really gonna stick, you know what I mean? But they, even the people involved in the drug economies don't know the connections that exist between, you know, our consumption and distribution and production and in Latin America, right? Between the war on drugs and the prison industrial complex. So it's really urgent.
I'm not seeing a hand, I can project myself. Oh, I missed one.
All right. I have an idea. You mentioned I think North American Free Trade Agreement and economic, and I'm thinking North America. What's going on with Canada? I mean, it's you only have across 3 states, California, Oregon, and Washington, and you're at the Canadian border, or Vancouver's not that far away by boat. And of course, the United States can exert a lot of pressures politically, economically, and so forth on Canada. Is Canada
Are they just, you can educate me, taking in some of these Central American, South American refugees? Or could they do more? Or what's your feeling on Canadian?
Canada did a lot in the 1980s. I mean, they immediately granted refugee status. Any Central American that was lucky enough to get to Canada didn't have their kids deported to Canada. You know, and there are very large populations of Central American immigrants in Canada. So Canada, of course, has a much, much, much more humane refugee program. As I do not know about, I will have to research that. I'm not sure that they are actually going to Canada. Believe it or not, a lot of these women are fleeing to Nicaragua. Poorest country in Central America, least amount of crime, destroying all ideas that we have about the relation between poverty and criminality. And yes, the women who like think, you know, I'm not going to cross that, I'm not going to do it, you know, it's a big burden for the poorest country in Central America, but they are taking in women and children, refugees. So I think, you know, Canada, they have to figure out a way to get there that would have to entail crossing the United States. You know, I think that if for those who are probably wealthy enough to fly, and there are those who might have visas, then they very well may offer Canada. But we're talking about people who are doing, you know, are pretty, have very few resources, and who might, in a lot of cases, you know, have to really decide. So with some of these women, like, I was thinking they were going to all be like coyotes, and, you know, the trip from Central America is $70,000, and other, I don't know, maybe they boost. Oh, no, I just came to the bus. I was like, oh, okay. You know, that's not very expensive, you know, to just get on the bus and get here, you know. But it's still a level of security that the kids that are riding the trains, you know, the top of the trains, don't have, right? So I think it all depends on access. Canada does supply, probably about 4 to 10% of our marijuana. It supplies all of our ecstasy. Not all of it, but all of the ecstasy that comes from abroad comes from Canada. Canada is the number one producer of ecstasy. And that's significant. Why? Because that's one of the top three drugs that kids do. Like now, of course, heroin is on the rise, and it's really a different era. But up until this burst of heroin addiction, marijuana, cocaine, and heroin were like dead last on the top 10 drugs that kids use. So, you know, we're like kind of off the pulse, you know, like we might be thinking like, oh, you know, they're really using cocaine and heroin, but they're not the most popular drugs. Things like methamphetamines and ecstasy is what you use. So Canada does have a role to play in the drug problem, but of course it does. It's never figured as such.
Let me ask a little bit more about the issue of gender violence, because you stressed several things in the possible that number one, the violent threats go to boys and girls, men and women, just in different ways. We stress that Maras are a kind of army, and that they do have certain reproductive needs. So they want people to cook, they want sex available, etc. And those are plausible points. There is literature on the use of sexual threats, including rape, as a military tactic. And it is not a universal military tactic. That seems clear. Some armies do it, and some don't. And people try and figure out why, and there aren't definitive answers, but, you know, one answer is that some armies are concerned to terrorize the civilian population, and others are not so concerned to terrorize the civilian population. They just want to kill the other troops and win the war, but they don't feel the need to terrorize the civilian population. And there are claims that, at least in some regions, the use of rape as a tactic in particular has really been an effort to destroy the identity of another people by creating children who whose identities are challenged because of their parentage, and it's a peculiar form of genocide. And I've been assuming that maybe terror threat tactic is the explanation for the emphasis here, if it's one of those two. But since these issues of indigeneity and identity are part of your paper, part of your concerns, I wondered if the other argument has any purchase, or if there are other explanations you have as to why there is, according to these stories, this persistent pattern, this kind of threat.
Well, I do think that, especially in Guatemala and the civil war there, the paramilitary groups and the military systematically use rape as a form of torture and terror and subduing populations, and precisely making these women the reproductive vessels of their military. But here's what I'm not quite ready to say that the Maras use rape as a tactic. I think that rather it's like one of the number of services that women are expected to perform in the case of, and I don't think that it's rampantly being used in that way. I think, because in other words, in each case, if these women could make their extortion payments, everything was cool. It was once they couldn't make their extortion payments, not in every case, but of the women who were fleeing because they couldn't make the extortion payments, that was the case. I mean, okay, you have to prove your, so I'm not sure that they're deploying it as a tactic, but they certainly do expect, like they expect you to turn over your kids to them at 10, whether they're boys or girls, and it just so happens that one of the tasks that the girls are going to be expected to perform may be sexual. And they even put it that way, ask them, and maybe, they weren't, not everyone was saying necessarily that their girls were going to be, but they knew that this was one of the things that their girl would be expected to do, right, by joining, she's effectively joining the gang, she's a forced recruit, and therefore she's going to have to do whatever the gang says. But I don't necessarily know that that's like the same as rape as a tactic of war. But I think that when, for the mothers who had their daughters who were fleeing because their daughters had been threatened in this way, often at the expense of leaving boys behind, it was this additional threat that really, really motivated their travel. So I think that in that sense, I'm not sure it's a tactic in the same way that we saw in these very same wars, 20, 30 years ago by both the Salvadoran and the Guatemalan National Guard. But
not of their own volition, the
enchiladas are part of this gang structure, and so how is their criminality being constructed in the Northern Triangle? I actually haven't done the research that would be necessary for that. They are predominantly represented as gangs made up of men and boys. And I also, for example, don't know, there are entire prisons like, devoted to maras in El Salvador and Honduras and Guatemala. I don't know if they have their counterpart for female maras. That would be a very important area of community research, actually. Because not every girl is getting out, obviously. You know, the vast majority probably aren't getting out, you know. And so I do think that, that will have to be a really important area of research. That's really important. Also, the maras who are caught here, the girls, you know, the girls that are part of the maras, how many, you know, what percentage of those 40,000 sent back to Salvador were girls? That's a very important question. I don't know the answer to. I think, as generally, you know, I assume that it was, you know, men, but you're right, there's probably a number of women in the deportations as well.
Thank you. I know that your analysis is situated within the situation that we find ourselves in. As you say, if women and children are being given benefits for immigration, that's good. We should work with it as we find it. But I'm wondering if you could also just clarify.
And boys under
18. I'm wondering if you could also clarify still your overarching moral vision that is explaining your critique, specifically your critique of U.S. liberalism. Say there are limits to U.S. liberalism. Is it the control of mobility as such, immigration as such, or is it a system that doesn't give precedence to people fleeing violence that has in some way been caused by the U.S.? Because under the second of those scenarios, there's still going to be a situation of likely over-demand for immigration or fleeing to the U.S., and then there will still be the problem of having to say no to people who are trying to flee some sort of oppressive situation. And so I know, again, you're working in a more engaged, situated way, but still, you must have some broader...
Oh, I do.
I mean,
I mean, Emma Yuka said it in 1930, I'll say it again, the border should be completely open for migrants. There should not be borders. Why? Because U.S. citizenship was never founded. It was not founded in a vacuum. U.S. citizenship only exists by virtue of the ability that it had, by virtue of the way in which it's violated the rights of citizens all over Latin America. To me, that's the really fundamental criticism of liberalism for me. It's like, we have this idea that citizenship is nationally founded, and yet, the rights only accrue to those members of that citizenship, but the obligations extend all over the world for the U.S., right? I mean, everybody else is under obligation to provide secure citizenship for the United States at whatever cost, right? Historically, 200 years of this, you know, more, I guess now, it's been a long time since 1976. But, you know, it's so in my view, absolutely, there should at least be open borders between the governments, of between the countries that are part of NAFTA and CAFTA, because NAFTA and CAFTA have changed something. Something that had never been changed before, right? And that was they made these borders completely porous to goods and financial investment, direct financial investment. And I could bore you with the details of deindustrialization in Mexico to eat ad nauseum. You can also read the epilogue of the book because actually a lot of it is in the book, but in being given. But, you know, I mean, we actively deindustrialized Mexico, not to actively deindustrialize Mexico. But yet their goods and capital can flow, but not workers. I mean, that's just not the way capitalism works. It's like naive to think capitalism works that way. So why are we adhering to principles of liberal citizenship and borders if we're violating this? And I do have a unique purchase on this because, as I said, I've been doggedly after NAFTA since 1992. And my ex-brother-in-law was Senator Mitchell's right-hand man negotiating NAFTA. And I cannot tell you the number of papers. Read this, Sam! Read this! You're going to see the immigration pump. It's going to be huge. Look at the deindustrialization of that. Finally, like at the third Thanksgiving or whatever, he was like, Josie, we know, but we cannot sell the third leg of this. We cannot sell people on open borders on labor because we are just too racist. And then I was like, oh, okay. Well, I mean, that's that, you know?
Just to follow up, you're calling for the open borders within NAFTA or
without
NAFTA?
Because
CAFTA and CAFTA, North American Free Trade Accord and Central American.
That's right. So the, within that community.
Which includes the Caribbean. The Caribbean is part of the CAFTA.
Can I just ask a quick question to follow
up? Is this a two-finger point?
Yeah, it is two-finger. All right. Has there been work comparing this situation with the EU? It really strikes me that the whole kind of fantasy of the EU also was about this idea of open borders that included the flow of people. But the problem of immigration and the problem of religion right now looks very similar to the United States. And it really makes me think about these questions around, the question of agency and human rights, because you're talking about a political system versus an economic system. And I think that insofar as the story that you always get with Chinese immigrants and with Latino immigrants, is that they're economic refugees. These are not political refugees. That's a long kind of history that you're working
with. I mean, they are political refugees in my view because they've been subject to U.S. foreign policy for, 200 years. There are political scientists who have definitely worked on this. James Hollifield is the one that I use, the liberal paradox, but I imagine there are many others in the field. So there have been comparisons of the EU and not so, especially around the issue of labor being constrained, whereas it was in the EU. But I don't, I do think they're having a very similar, reaction at this point to immigrants coming from beyond the EU borders, right? I mean, this Brexit was about being, subject to Polish and Ukrainian workers, but it's also about being beyond, about the waves of immigration beyond, I think it's also.
Yes, I have a question connecting the issue of the investment in a national form of citizenship is connected to the inability to bring indigeneity into consideration in different scholarly approaches. Because it seemed like indigeneity has a particular claim to national status that is not inherent within the United States, that is not necessarily shared by other ethnic groups who doesn't have, obviously, the exact same history. So I'm wondering if part of this, this erasure of indigeneity comes about because there is still a heavy investment in a national form of citizenship that must extend and provide these rights.
Absolutely. I mean, it is an irony that such a significant portion of the migrant population from Mexico is indigenous, descendants of indigenous peoples from the Americas, and yet they're constructed as foreigners, right? I mean, to me, that's profoundly wrong. And I do think it's because of the way in which the U.S. has erased indigenous histories in formation of our own national, without question. Because if you, not that if we hadn't erased it, we would be willing to recognize, Mayan and Zapotec and Mixtec and, Chol and Tocalabal and all the mix of immigrants who have come as rightfully belonging to the citizens, the citizens of this nation, but it might have provided for a greater understanding of our own tenuous claim, like an immigrant as European and other immigrants, our own tenuous claim on this continent, maybe. I mean, it's not like Mexico's any party for indigenous people. But I do think that in the 80s, we did see an identification. The fact that when Mexico took in 2 million Guatemalan immigrants, refugees along the border during the 1980s, of course there was incredible racism about them for being against the Indians, but that was part of the reason why they felt they had to do it. They were right across the border, but it was patriarchal, patronizing, esos pobres indios, los tenemos que ayudar, But, hey, it worked, for 14 years, they had refugee status in Mexico, right? So, and even today, I was astounded. Somebody's wrong, I was like, why did you leave Mexico if Mexico gave you refugee status? And they were like, my family's here, I couldn't get a job. I mean, they had good reasons for leaving, but You know, some of these women had gotten refugee status in Mexico.
Any questions? Yes.
So just let me ask you a small factual question, and then I want to sort of follow up on Jeff's question, natural matter question about the way you're, which I think you interpret as the way you're operationalizing citizenship specifically. So the whole question is, when men are separated from their wives and daughters in these detention centers, how do they establish the credible threat that if the fear, the credible fear, if their peers or their daughters, if they're telling separate stories in separate detention centers? Do these men, can they use those stories?
Yeah.
Or do they have to establish some independence?
No, they can use the same story. They can, and they will. You know, I mean, unless it's made up, they will. They will tell the same story. Oftentimes, I chose the cases of the women who came because of fear of their daughters, but oftentimes the entire family has been threatened. And so I didn't actually get a case of a woman who had been separated from her husband, but you know, it happens with frequency. So, but there are cases in which the madres have just forced the entire family to flee for other complicated reasons, or the whole family has fled because they wanted to flee together. You know, they'll have witnessed a crime by the madres. They'll have made the mistake of going to the police, and the police will have investigated. I mean, there's ways in which entire families are put into motion too. Absolutely, yeah.
So, there isn't anything about those other questions. It's going to sound blunt, if not obtuse. But it's about the notion that U.S. citizenship is premised on the horrible things that U.S. policy has done, right? And I agree with everything you said in that regard. It's wrong. It's immoral. We've done bad things to interfere with the introduction of democracy in other countries. And we have done it for money, power, whatever sorts of reasons we have. And I do understand that, agree that U.S. wealth has certainly been developed on the backs of these atrocities that you're documenting. And of course, power on the global stage. We also all understand the notion that every inside has to have an outside, right? And we all are hearing, you know, the Trump supporters say, no, we want to make America great again, and the way to make America great again is to be racist, right, and to exclude people. But there's a lot of us who are also horrified at that discourse. We may vote for Hillary Clinton or Bernie, you know, have support for Bernie Sanders, but they're all going to do the same thing from what you're saying, right, that they're not really any different on immigration. So there isn't any place for American citizens to go that will help push U.S. foreign policy in a different direction. So I guess I want to know, in what way are you operationalizing citizenship? Are you assimilating it to, you know, these things are immoral, these things are, you know, treat people as inhuman, they treat them in inhumane ways. We are morally complicit at some level in these horrible things. But in what sense is U.S. citizenship premised on these sorts of activities specifically? That's what I'm trying to get to, too.
And I actually think that it is, philosophically, not just historically. And this is the part that's going to be much harder for you to work out. But I actually do believe that it's philosophically premised on this. I mean, it will involve going back to, political, early American political theory about this, right? But I think that the U.S., I want to make the argument that not morally, I mean, we may win arguments morally, but I want to make a political argument that U.S. citizenship is contingent, that citizenship, period, is contingent on citizenship in one nation is contingent ontologically on citizenship. That's the argument I want to make. I don't think I've made it successfully yet, Lindsay, but that's the argument I want to make. That they're actually mutually constituted. That no national citizen exists except by virtue of the modes in which other citizenships have also been produced. I think Central America is the perfect case for it in a way, because those interventions are so recent, right? I mean, one could, you know, of course, make the argument that U.S. citizenship was premised on a particular understanding of what it meant to be human that necessarily excluded, indigenous and African American citizens. I mean, that might be one way to go, but I actually think that in a much more, from a Latin American genealogy, there has been a constant production of Latin American, of U.S. citizenship at the expense, politically, philosophically, economically, of U.S. Of Latin American citizenship. I don't know if I'll be able to make that argument, but that's the argument I want to make. I think that the moral argument is clear. I think there's a huge difference between, you know, what Hillary Clinton will do and what Obama's doing. To be perfectly honest, I think in terms of Latinos, well, not good. I think Hillary will actually be more attentive or more responsive or commit to, you know, fulfill the promises she's made to Latino populations, both with, you know, ending family detention and with a path to citizenship for the 12 million Mexican immigrants that are here illegally, right? So I actually do think it makes a big difference. I mean, maybe perhaps not between Bernie and Hillary, but even between Hillary and Obama, I think there's a lot of daylight. And that's in part because of the long history that the Clintons have with the Latino community. It's a horrible history, for God's sakes. You know, every time I cringe, you know, I've got to pull that lever when the Clintons gave a barbecue for the Contras. How many of you remember that? They went to give a barbecue for the Contras when they were governor and first lady. And, you know, Clinton did nothing with the end of our rule. I mean, in other words, the Central American case, I just think it could be so paradigmatic for this argument of how citizenship is contingent, right? When national citizenship in one part of the globe is contingent on the production of national citizenship in another, or the kind of limitations, I think I can make that argument. Like, that wasn't supposed to be this next book, you know, but I think it's going to have to be part of it.
So I want to take you back to one of the points you raised at the end, which was the question about narrative and representation. And I'm wondering what kinds of strategies you see, because this is something I struggle with also, as available for not reproducing those narratives of the savage slant, right, while still trying to put forward the power of the narrative that you're writing about. What is it that you think politically can motivate a reader or a listener to receive those narratives as a call to action rather than a call to plea? And how do you feel in these scenarios of extraordinary violence where people have been really living with this constantly? I mean, this is not like I guess I should put it as a question. Like, how is it that one might use these narratives to reveal the ongoing historical and structural violences and not just the narrative of what the Maras did, you know, last month? You know what I mean? Like, how can you how do you do that?
Well, until this crisis of the women really came into view, I teach this not this class almost every year, and invariably, you know, in the middle of it, NYU is a very expensive school, and we're dead last in financial aid, so invariably, like, dealers come out in class, right, like students who are dealers, and so, and I try to make them feel like, you know, we can change the drug, we can end the war on drugs, it's going to happen I try to encourage them to believe it's going to happen within their lifetime, and it should be a political priority for anyone who uses drugs, you know, distributes drugs, you know, wants to continue to have drugs in their lives. You know, I mean, 20 years ago, we never would have thought we would have legalized gay marriage.
You know, and this is what I always tell them. It's like, this is within reach, especially with the legalization of marijuana that's happening everywhere. So I'm like, you know, you have to really, in terms of like politics, you have to choose your battles. Of course, and I think that that's a really, really, really important one to fight, you know, the ending of the drug war. Even if we don't decriminalize drugs and we just end the drug war, right, and the trillions of, you know, the trillion dollars that we spend abroad, that would make a huge, huge difference in the lives of everyday Central Americans and Mexican Americans. But I also, you know, as you say, it's like the entering of these women into the picture does add a level of, you know, pathologizing that I was not expecting to have to deal with. It's like not pathologizing them as the victims of their gender, right? Maybe victors of their gender, but they are. I think it's very hard not to use the narrative that's out there about protecting women and children. It's very, I mean, I don't know that I would hesitate from doing that. You know what I mean? It's like, but I think that it's how do we talk about it? I don't know. I mean, I'm just as open to hearing about it as you hear. I mean, I do think that in terms of representing them, I think it's important for me to underscore their agency in all of this. And you know, these women, as I said, you know, this is a last choice. They don't decide we're going to do it. You know, something provoked it. You know, and they were actually incredibly, you know, figuring out a way to live. Living with day-to-day violence is just the norm. You know what I mean? And so that, you know, this, that's the, that it's not a state of exception for them. It's just the state of affairs, you know? And I do think that a counter narrative, a very important counter narrative, is the case of Nicaragua, which I didn't get a chance to get into here. But I don't know. I mean, maybe making them into the actual heroes of their own stories, right? Because they have, you know, taken these huge risks, right, to come here, right? They've survived a lot, and you know, they've come here, and you know, I don't know. Does it sound very convincing to me? But you know, I do think that's a big challenge of this work. How not to develop?
Can I follow up with a question? I was wondering about the role of women and children before and after they flee their country. You were saying that the immigration policies and laws and the refugee process favors women and children less than 18. However, you know, as I think of women who are displaced in Colombia, whose partners, husbands, children, male children have been killed, and they are there alone. They are subject to sexual violence and rape. I wonder if there is an after, a before and after for women in that in their countries from where they are fleeing, they are really in a more violent position because they are women. And the story that you say about this mother who had to choose which children to bring seem to be, you know, an indicator that that's the case, that they are in a more precarious, more violent situation at home than men. So, you know, could you tell, in response to this question about the narrative, or perhaps in relation to it, not in response, but could you tell the story of gender violence also before in such a way that it doesn't seem like, you know, oh, they're taking advantage of a more benevolent position towards them because they're women, you know?
Absolutely, and I mean, I said that in the crowd, but I would never necessarily commit that to paper, right, that it's about taking advantage of it. I mean, they're using they're inventing a new category too, because the category does not exist for them. Right, and so there, when they get released from Dili, they get an appointment to eventually go in front of an asylum judge. That can take, you know, with appeals, it can take anywhere from 2 to 3 years for that process to go through its course. Whether or not they are granted asylum is entirely subjective on the parts of the judge, because they don't necessarily they don't fit a politically persecuted person, And it really depends, like, you know, Florida, New York, the places you would expect, California, lenient judges, all get approved. Atlanta, Texas, never get approved. You know, I mean, they kind of tracks the rates of approval of their refugee cases, you know, so it's pretty stark depending on who's the judge there. But this is, I think this is a really good point that you made, that, you know, they're just because they're the subjects of gender violence doesn't mean that they have been victimized in every aspect of their life beforehand. I think that's a very important thing to underscore. In fact, the women who were business owners have a better shot because there's some weird quirk in the law that's about female business owners. That depending if you're a savvy lawyer and you know the law, so there's some caveat somewhere. I'm not a lawyer, but there's a caveat even for like women-owned businesses. So you know that's another weird quirk in the law. You know, like if they're so. I think that's perhaps the way of highlighting that. These are very agentful people there and here, you know? I mean, and that's what's really striking. Even the cases of domestic violence, I'm like, you're right. I don't understand why we didn't act before this either. Because all of the four cases that I dealt with, well, no, three or four, the fourth is a total exception. But the three of the four, you know, all of them said, I don't know why, you know, I was able to stop my mother's abuse, and I don't know, and I left when he had turned on my children. I don't know why I wasn't able to defend myself. You know, so there is this, even for those women, there was that, you know, they had stood up to their violent fathers, you know, and they were able to stand up to men when it was their children, but for them, it was not possible until this point, right? So, I mean, I do think that there is a lot of ways, and I thank you for that, of conveying their, and on the basis of their gender, right? There is. The other thing to remember is, like, you know, this is the other thing with the lawyers that were volunteering with me were like, oh my God, they're so brave. I'm like, you know, Central Americans, they're like 75% female in households. Like, I don't know about the Northern Triangle, but in Nicaragua, 75% of households in Nicaragua are led by women. And I'm just like women, they will not put up with you. If, you know what I mean? Like, they just kick them out. They're like, you know, you're not gonna be a responsible father, get out, you know? And they just go on to live their own life, which also makes them vulnerable in certain ways. You see what I'm saying? So it's the fact that they have been agentful and haven't necessarily, you know, relied on the man that actually also makes them somewhat vulnerable in ways that men aren't necessarily.
This point, I want to say first, I share your belief that we came in the drug war, and that might take away one structural factor contributing to these conditions. And I also know that it's time to end the session. So I want to thank you.